Hey, Stacy, when we get to heaven, will you let me sing with you guys? Okay. I guarantee you, that's the only time you'd want to hear me sing. Greater witness. The Great Commission, Jesus commands us to be a witness. That is why we are here. To tell people about Jesus so that people can be saved. We have each speaking to those around us who do not know the Lord Jesus Christ. Bobby preached 2 weeks ago about the heart of a soul winner. The beginning part of that is to be a witness. Out of our heart are the issues of life, and that issue of our life should be to tell others about Jesus Christ. This church, Acts 1:8, witnessing is paramount. It is preeminent with what this church does, and the leadership of this church is to be a witness. The slide background, it's hard to see, is an aerial of Blue Springs. It represents the people that we are to be a witness to. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for all the blessings to hear the praise this morning, to hear about your blessed name, Lord. And I just pray right now that your word, the words from the truth, from your words, will touch everyone's heart here today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I was very blessed to have Christian parents. To be raised in a Christian home at a church called Ruby Avenue Baptist Church, a small basement church in Argentine, Kansas. Went to Sunday school, and back then, as a child, you sat in the service. So I went to Sunday service in the morning. I went to Sunday service at night. Went to Wednesday service. My parents had Bible study at their home. Went to vacation Bible school. In fact, my mom sent me to 2 vacation Bible schools at different churches. She knew that I needed it. Sat in the service during week-long revivals. Thankful. And we also the church custodians. So I was very blessed with that. I'm thankful that I have a godly wife. In Revelation 2 and 3, it has a picture of the church history of 7 churches, the church age. And a church that had the greatest witnessing throughout the world is represented by the Philadelphian church. I was very fortunate to be under strong, sound preaching growing up from men that had been influenced during that Philadelphian church age. Strong preaching. Jesus tells us about that church. He says, works. It does take work. It says, I know they have little strength, but he opened doors. He said, I know thou hast kept my word and hast not denied my name, the name of Jesus. And that's the pattern that this church is the same. We are commanded by Jesus Christ that ye shall be witnesses. The great commandments that talk about to love the Lord, to love others, and of course to love one another. The greatest way that you can express love is to tell them about Jesus. We're going to look at just three biblical doctrinal truths today that if you receive them, it will make you a greater witness. And there's a twofold application here. It will make you a greater witness, but these three doctrinal truths will become foundational stones in your Christian life so that you can be strong, so that you will not be moved no matter what comes our way. I had a friend in college who flew an F-14 Tomcat on a carrier. And he told me about, he was coming in, there was a hydraulic malfunction, and he crashed, but he hurt his left leg. He's okay, but it reminded me of a illustration that I heard as a young man that I will never forget. It was about another pilot coming in, and there was a malfunction. He knew that he was going to crash. He radioed ahead. Emergency vehicles were out there. The people to help were there. The first responders. And as he came in, yes, he did crash. The fuselage of that plane, though, trapped him inside. And as he's there and all the vehicles are coming out and all the sirens and all the noise that's happening and the plane burst into flames, that jet fuel. The roar of that flame, over all of the emergency vehicles, the sound, the yelling, the sirens, they said you could hear over all of that, you could hear a man's voice that said, "Cut off my leg! Will make you a greater witness. Salvation, the gospel, it's the good news story, but hell is an integral part of that. The gospel is salvation. Salvation, think about this. Salvation, to be saved, to be rescued, to be delivered. Salvation is being saved from what? It's to be saved from eternal punishment. From punishment that does not stop. Salvation is being rescued from God's judgment for rejecting him. I know a song Milt sang about, throw out the lifeline. Turn to Matthew chapter 5. In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus had come from Jerusalem, and he made his way down to Galilee to start his ministry. He was on a mountain, the Sermon on the Mount, because he was surrounded by so many people, because they had been following him. They had flocked to see him. But just prior to this sermon, Jesus had spent 40 days under attack from Satan, face to face with evil, knowing what evil was trying to do to creation. In verse 22, Matthew 5:22, "But I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca," or you're calling him a fool, "shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, Thou fool, shall be in danger of hell fire." Jesus spoke about hell more than he spoke about heaven. He described it here in simple terms: hell fire. That dispels any person that would think or has said hell is just the grave, because it's got a description there, the two-word description. It says hell fire. Jesus preached more about hell than anyone in the Bible. Jesus preached, in fact, he preached more about hell than all of them combined teachers in the Bible. Jesus preached on hell here, and he referenced it three times in Matthew chapter 5. Jesus preached about hell in Matthew chapter 10. Jesus preached and taught people about hell in chapter 11. Jesus preached on hell in chapter 18. Jesus preached on hell multiple times also in chapter 23. Jesus preached on hell and told us a description of hell in Luke 16 that we'll look at here in just a minute. Jesus preached hell as part of the Gospels. Wherever he went, Jesus preached on hell. Jesus was a hellfire preacher. And again, we relate it to salvation, to being rescued, to be delivered. When we talk about salvation, the word has to be used. Hellfire, a two-word description. We know that hell is not the grave. Three different times in the Bible, as it's talking about hell, in Matthew 3, chapter 3, chapter 13, Mark 9, it talks about hell being an unquenchable fire. Here in that In 5:22, it talks about a fool. But a fool is a wicked reprobate, someone that is destitute of all spirituality. They've rejected Jesus Christ. Hell is a place of eternal punishment for the wicked. Jesus, in doing this preaching, it was a warning to all the people, his creation. He loves the people. It was a warning to sinners about hell. He wanted to warn them so that they could escape, to be delivered from the reality of hell. Turn to Luke chapter 16. We'll look at verse 23. You know the story here about Lazarus and the rich man. Luke 16:23. And this is about the rich man. It said he died and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. The rich man was able to see, he was able to talk, he was able to hear, he experienced physical pain. We need to have an awareness of hell. Conscience, awareness in torment. In that story there in the scriptures, you can see where it is also a place of memory and remorse over his lost condition that he was in hell. The rich man had an awareness of hell. But it was too late. We need to have an awareness of hell now. It'll make us a greater witness. Hell is a reality. The Bible is clear, though, that hell was created for eternal punishment. But it was not meant for you or I. It was meant for Satan and his fallen angels, according to Matthew 25, 41. No man needs to go there. Satan and his angels will be sent to hell forever. Satan and his angels committed a crime. They committed a crime of rebelling against God. They rejected God. Even though they experienced heaven, they rejected Jesus Christ because they have a free will, just like you and me. The consequence is punishment, torment, everlasting burning in hell. Unbelievers that rebel against God are from the family of Satan. We're all in the family of Satan because of sin, according to 844. You have your father, the devil, because of sin. So unbelievers will receive the same punishment, the same nature of punishment, and the same duration of punishment because they committed the same crime. They rebelled against God. They rejected Jesus. Eternal punishment, punishment that is forever. A conscious life, a conscious existence in a body resurrected and suited for everlasting punishment. In growing up, Pastor Roscoe Brewer gave an illustration called The Faces in Hell. And I'll never forget it. What he said was, in your mind, picture family or loved ones or friends or neighbors, people you know, picture their face, that you know them, that are unbelievers. Picture that face as you've had conversations with them, as you've seen them, as you do things with them, as you work side by side with them. Picture their face. Now, picture that face in burning hell, in flames, in need to have an awareness of hell. Now, he was on the mount because the multitude of the people were there. They loved Jesus when he was giving them food, when he was feeding them, when he was performing the miracles, when he was raising the dead and the sick and healing them. But they did not like it when he started preaching about hell. God is loving, yes, but he's also a righteous God. The miracles are great, but they do not want to hear about the divine righteous judgment. It's not popular. It was not popular. The people did not like it then. Don't like it today. Awareness of hell must motivate me to be a greater witness. Now, in hearing this, God's word, every person here, each one of you is going to do one of two things today. You're going to do one of two things. And the Bible is clear about that. It talks about that in Matthew 13. That's the parable about sowing. It talks about your spiritual roots. One thing that some people here will do today is emotionally they will be offended. By the time we're done. Or the second thing that can happen, you can react with that emotion or you can respond with heart being convicted. In Matthew 13:21, it says, because of the word, by and by, he is offended. God's word will offend. You can emotionally react and be offended, or you can respond with your heart and be convicted. We need to respond to the Holy Spirit. We need to search our hearts. And as you're searching your heart, today is the day. Do not leave this building without making it right with God. In fact, the solution, the answer to both of those responses is the same. And that's to come down to this altar and make it right with God. Sin awareness will make you a greater witness. As this second biblical doctrine, this foundational stone. Because biblical sin has been compromised the day we live in. We live in a world where sin is freely exploited. Sin is so much a part of our culture that almost every sin is acceptable. So because of that, we become comfortable with sin. We become used to sinning, and we become very comfortable with sin, and that results in a society in which there are very few consequences because of sin. We, people, our children, are growing up in a world where things that were once defined as sin are no longer being defined as sin. Immoral behavior has no consequence in society. We become comfortable with sin because there's very few consequences for sin. There is a warped sense of good and evil, and it distorts an understanding of justice. Relativism removes biblical definition of what sin is because there's no absolute truth. There's no accountability for sin. There's no consequence for sin. We live in a world, in a society, in a culture that basically I can do whatever I want. Now, if culture imposes no consequence for sin, and the family imposes no consequence for sin, society places no shame or disgrace or dishonor on sin, and sin is without consequences, it becomes impossible to understand God's righteous judgment. Because there's no consequence. There's no discipline. So then you cannot explain to someone that there will be a day of reckoning, that there will be a judgment time, that your sin will be judged. Consequence, discipline, something I learned very young. My mom was swift to administer discipline and consequence to me, and many times. She had a board on the washing machine, and when I would disobey, out of love, my mom called me by my whole name, Stephen Leroy. There was a ditch behind our house, and I loved playing there, and I wasn't supposed to go there, and I knew I messed up. Just like you and I, we know. She would talk to me, I disobeyed, she would administer the Board of Education to my backside. I understood consequence. I understood accountability. Even as a young boy, I needed to reconcile with my mother, confess our sin, confess my sin, be accountable for my sin. Just like today, because of sin in our life, we need to reconcile with God. I need to be accountable for that. I need to confess. Very simply, I need to get things right. There's anything in your life today, you know what? You need to get things right with God. Isaiah 5:20 is the world we're living in. Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Because sin has been compromised, and think about it, all this acceptable sin, there's easy access to every sin in this world. Satan's plan, if he eliminates sin, there's no reason to repent. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That death there is very clear. We know that death is a consequence, is hell. Because of sin being compromised, all of these tracks, Larry Franklin's famous tracks, We had them in Oaxaca. We've handed them out throughout the world and even here. It starts out how? By writing down a sin. So because we have a loving Heavenly Father and He knows us, by accepting Him, we know then that sin can be removed. How simple it is. I'm so thankful. I'm thankful that I've accepted Jesus Christ, that He is covered. The blood on the cross has covered my sin. But you can see how this world wants to make this to where you can't understand it. Without sin, there's no need for repentance. Now, awareness of sin has a twofold application. We've just discussed the application so that you can know about that there is righteous judgment, that there is accountability. But another application for awareness of sin as believers is for our separation from sin. We're to be sanctified. My sanctification, my getting clean, my getting away from sin never stops. I need to have that awareness. Bobby's dad, the story where Bobby's dad was driving on a Sunday morning and he saw the deacons of the church behind the church smoking. Now, to Bobby's dad, that was wrong. We're not going to get into defining sin. The Bible defines it. Your heart defines it. It'll tell you what sin is. But I need to understand that unbelievers are looking for any reason, any small reason, anything to reject our witness. They're looking for any excuse to reject our witness. It affected your father, Bobby. The Bible clearly tells us, as saved, born again, washed in the blood believers, we are held to a higher standard. 1 Peter 1:16, because it is written, "Be ye holy, for I am holy." We are held to a higher standard. I need to search my heart. Preparing this has broken me. An awareness of sin. We need to fill this altar today, asking God, not what people are saying sin is, but asking God to give us conviction, that Holy Spirit to convict us. And the reason is because we have become, even as believers, we have become soft on sin. Now, that's not my words. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says we have come and we are lukewarm. That's what the Bible says. Me, I've become lukewarm on sin. When my first grandchild was born, the first thing that hit me, first thing, I don't want to do anything that could hinder my grandson of going to heaven, of being saved. I don't want to do anything that could prevent him from knowing Jesus Christ, because the consequence is hell. For this foundational stone of preaching about sin in my life, to give me a foundation to stand on, to keep me aware. I need to be spotless clean. I need to be a greater witness. The third doctrinal truth is God's design awareness. In 2 Peter 3:9, and most of you know that verse, it said, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." This verse has hit me like a ton of bricks. He's not willing that any should perish. Of course, that's hell. And that all should come to repentance, to understanding and addressing sin. Our Heavenly Father created us, and he loves his creation. Because of that, he would absolutely design us to be as close to salvation as possible, but still provide us with a free will. We're going to look at some verses, but if you look at these, his design is very clear. He has designed every one of us, each one of us, everyone that we're praying for, he's designed us to have our toes right on the line, right on the line to taking that next step of faith. Right on the line, as close as possible to him to receive that gift of salvation. Because he loves us, we're his creation. He designed us to be right there. This has changed my whole perspective of the people that I need to witness to. I need to look at them as being right there on the line with their hands out. It makes it a lot easier. When you think about him and you have that perspective. Because he loves us. He created us. He's going to make us that way. Your DNA has a supernatural awareness of God being our creator. He created, he built into us an awareness of him. John 1:9, that was the true light that lighteth every man that cometh into the world. John 1:4, in him was life, and that life was the light of men. We have been born with a light of reason inside of us, a light, a sense that is derived directly from our Creator, that was given to us from God. He made us for his pleasure. That's why we're here. He created us. He made us to be with him. But he still gives us free will because we decide we want to be with him. God's being, his character, we know is clearly seen from his creation in Romans 1:20. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood, we can understand that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they, his creation, are without excuse. God's outward creation supernaturally is a catalyst, it's a motivator, it speaks to us to accept him as Savior. Our conscience is a witness for God. Our own conscience reveals it bears God's desire to save us from judgment and to reward us with an abundant life on earth and eternity in heaven. That's how we're made. Romans 2:15, it says, which show the works of the law, this is the law, written in their hearts. It's written in our hearts, their conscience, also bearing witness, and their thoughts, and the meanwhile accusing or else excusing another. They have a supernatural awareness that's built into them. All I got to do is be a light. Let me tell you about Jesus. Let me tell you about my life. Oh, my. Titus 2:11. It gets better. It gets better. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. God's grace, his love, his compassion applies to every man. No matter what you are, no matter what you've done, no matter where you are in life, that grace appears to you. The free, unlimited favor of God and the influence of the Holy Spirit is present in all men. Eternal salvation hath appeared, and it's been manifested, and it's been shown to them. Their toes are right here, but the world we live in is dark. They're just looking for a light. This happened in Zambia. But when it got dark there, it really got dark. This is how simple it is. God just wants us to be a light. They're right there. They need something to help them make that next step. Their toes are on the line. A few years ago, Cindy and I, our neighbor Mike, wanted us to come over because he'd had some remodeling done at his house. And he wanted to show us, so we went over and he's showing us and he's there with his wife and we're having a great time. So happy for the guy. Next morning, I get up and I hear his dog barking. Bark, bark, bark. Something didn't seem right. As I'm making my way over to Mike's house, I look, and I can see Mike on his front porch. But he's sitting, not in a chair, but he's sitting on the floor of the porch, and he's kind of slumped over. So I could sense something was wrong. So as I'm walking up, hey, Mike. No response. I get closer. I get on the porch, and as I'm looking, and of course I'm aware something's wrong. And as I'm looking, I noticed his diaphragm. There's no movement. I put my hand underneath his nose and here to see if I could sense anything. Mike was not breathing. He was dead. It hit me like a ton of bricks. Not so much his death, but had I ever witnessed to Mike? Some people were coming, another neighbor came over, and I walked back, and it knocked me down to my knees. Had I ever witnessed to Mike? And I suffered for about an hour. And then finally, I remember. I was open Mike on his deck and cutting out some stairs, some steps for him. And with sawdust here and stuff going on, somehow a door was opened. And I remembered then that I got to share the gospel with Mike. But God allowed me to go through a time there that I could not remember. He wanted me to experience death. Every head bowed, every eye closed. We have heard the Bible truth about rejecting Jesus Christ today, about the consequence of hell. Anyone here that's not saved, that has not accepted Jesus Christ, your conscience is crying out to you, your heart is crying out to you today to accept Jesus Christ. The music's going to start playing, and as it's playing, this is a time for you just to take a step, and come down forward, and somebody will tell you about accepting Jesus Christ. To be saved, to be delivered from hell, make that step right now if there's anyone here. As believers, let's give God a victory today by making a commitment to be a greater witness. Honor God with a renewed faithfulness. Come down, make it right with God if there's anything in your life. Make a commitment to Him, Lord, to be a greater witness, Lord. Get your heart right. Come down, Lord. Come down and tell the Lord, praying for open doors for you to be that witness. He'll do it. Their toes are right on the line. Come down to open those doors, asking Him to open those doors for you. Lord, we just want to give you all the praise and glory, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Make it right. Make it right with God. Hell is a reality. But heaven is a reality. Heaven is eternity. For you, he wants you to be with him. Just accept him. If you have not accepted him, now is the time. It's that simple.